The White House says President Trump is still considering a proposal by Vladimir Putin for the Kremlin to interrogate Americans, including a former U.S. ambassador to Moscow, in exchange for their assistance in the Mueller investigation. The State Department spokeswoman, however, was not on the same page as the White House.
Does President Trump support that idea? Is he open to having U.S. officials questioned by Russia?
The president's going to meet with his team, and we'll let you know when we have an announcement on that.
But what I can tell you is that the overall assertions that have come out of the Russian government are absolutely absurd.
Let's discuss this proposal with CNN legal analyst Michael Zeldin and CNN global affairs analyst Max Boot. Max, just when you think you've heard everything this week, there is yet a new wrinkle. We don't know much about what happened behind closed doors with President Trump and Vladimir Putin. However, President Trump did feel the need to come out and make this grand announcement of what the great offer was that Vladimir Putin had proposed to him behind closed doors. Let me remind people in Helsinki of this moment. Watch this.
What he did is an incredible offer. He offered to have the people working on the case come and work with their investigators with respect to the 12 people. I think that's an incredible offer.
Okay, let's take the president at his word, Max. He thinks that's an incredible offer. That wasn't a scripted response of his. He likes that offer. He's a deal maker. He thinks that that might just be a good deal. Your thoughts?
Allison, my thought is that he is right. This is an incredible offer, as in literally not credible. I mean, this is nuts. This is crazy. The Russians want us to turn over our former ambassador and Bill Browder, a British subject, so they can interrogate them on these phony, made-up charges designed to harass them. This was not a serious offer from Putin. He was basically trolling Trump. This was a cynical ploy.
But to what end? What kind of ploy?
Well, he was basically trying to suggest that the charges against the 12 Russian GRU officers who hacked into the DNC, which are amply documented, he was trying to suggest that those charges are equivalent to these phony, made-up charges that Putin has concocted against people who criticize him, like Mike McFaul and Bill Browder. And it was basically designed to deflect any pressure that he might have gotten from the U.S. to extradite these Russian military officers or to allow them to be questioned. Putin knows that no U.S. government could possibly accept such a quote-unquote offer. He was probably stunned when Donald Trump did not reject it. I mean, the proper response when you hear something like this from the Russian dictator is, put your offer where the sun don't shine. That's what a normal president would have said. So Putin was probably shocked, and we don't know exactly what Trump said, but based on what we've heard since then, he thought it was an incredible offer. He thought that was a good deal. I mean, the level of naivete being displayed by Donald Trump, even for him, this is shocking. The extent to which he is in the bag for the Russian dictator, oh my goodness. I mean, this is out of a horror movie.
Michael, is there any legal underpinning by which a deal like that could be made?
So I think you have to unpack the two sides of what is the deal. There is a mutual legal assistance treaty between the United States and Russia. It was signed in 2002 by President Bush. It provides for comprehensive assistance in criminal matters between the two countries. The United States, under this MLAT, Mutual Legal Assistance Treaty, under the MLAT, they could request Russia to cooperate with the ongoing Mueller investigation by gathering documents, interrogating witnesses, providing other information, and that would be an appropriate thing for the United States to ask for under the MLAT in and of itself.
Okay.
Whether Russia will cooperate.
But what about the flip side? Is that applicable?
Right. So I just want to give one half. So we could ask properly under the MLAT. Now, on the way back, there is no provision in the MLAT that allows for the interrogation of a U.S. Ambassador. In fact, in Article 4 of that MLAT, it specifically excludes matters that would be of a national security or other interest like this, and so we would have a basis under the treaty to deny it.
Okay.
And in the case of Browder, as Max said, there aren't really criminal charges that have been filed in the United States against him as to which we could provide assistance. So on the way in, it's completely bogus. On the way out, we have rights under this treaty, which the president should be asserting quite independent of the quid pro quo, if you will.
Okay. So, Max, what was that? The idea that the president thinks that that was a great deal, what other than just naked gullibility could that be? He announced it to the world. That's hardly a secret strategy. That's transparency. So what else could it be other than that he didn't understand what Putin was doing?
Well, that's the question that everybody is asking, Allison, and I was struck by the fact that just a few minutes ago on this show, Jim Clapper, the former director of national intelligence, said, based on what I saw at Helsinki, I really do wonder if Putin has something on Trump. A lot of people are wondering that, and a lot of them are former intelligence officers who have good cause for that speculation.
But again, he wouldn't be this public about this is a great deal if he had something secret on him. I mean,
I wouldn't necessarily conclude that. I mean, you can conclude that he is not very artful and not very subtle and not very smart. And at the same time, he could still be compromised by the Russians. In fact, those two things could easily go hand in hand.
Hey, Michael, the idea that Sarah Sanders says that the president and his team, it's an interesting idea, she said, I'm quoting, he didn't commit to anything. He wants to work with his team and determine if there is any validity that would be helpful to the process. I mean, surely his team understands the law as you've just laid it out.
Right. And his team should be the Office of International Affairs in the Department of Justice and the parties in the Department of State that handle these requests for assistance under the MLAT or letters rogatory or other international mechanisms for sharing. So he well could go to DOJ or state and say, what rights do we have in respect to the Mueller investigation that we should be forcefully asserting on our behalf? On behalf of Browder and the ambassador, that should be full stop, no way. It doesn't apply under the treaty. There's no basis for it, and we're not going to cooperate. But we do not expect these things to be tied. We expect you, Russia, to comply with your obligations under the treaty. The thing that's interesting, of course, is that Bill Browder, the guy who is of interest to the Russians, is the guy who, when kicked out of Russia for phony tax charges, hired a lawyer, Magnitsky, to investigate this. Magnitsky ends up dead in a Russian prison, which leads to sanctions and leads to the adoption prohibition. That's all of what was discussed on June 9th with Don Jr. So if you have a conspiratorial bone in your body, you look at this offer by Putin and you say, aha, this relates back to June 9th and Don Jr., and now we're coming full circle.
All right, thank you for tying that up so neatly for us. Michael Zeldin, Max Boot, thank you both very much.